Welcome to the latest edition of the SWN podcast. This is a special bonus. It was due to be a nice round table of Fife Pro Wrestling Asylum students. However, technical difficulties means it's just a, I don't want to say threesome, but that's the only word I've got coming into my head. We've joined by Ross Hunter and Nate Stevenson. So because Zoom makes a very weird noise, I'm going to pass you over one at a time to introduce. So we'll start off with Ross. Introduce yourself, tell a little bit about yourself.
How you doing, everybody? My name's Ross Hunter. I'm 16-year-old pro wrestler. Yes, I know, very oddly young. I'm a former MMA fighter, and I started wrestling 3 years ago now at W3L, and I'm now at FBWA.
And also joined by Nate Stevenson. A little bit about yourself.
I'm Nate. I've been wrestling for 2 years now. Started in Dundee and last year left and joined FPWA.
So these are two guys that are now under the tutelage of Andy Wild and is Johnny Lyons as well? You guys?
Yes, I was trained by Johnny for my time in W3L and yeah. I come with him to the juniors classes to help out.
Excellent. And yourself, Nate, was just we started Dundee. Was Johnny around there as well? No, he wouldn't have been. So
he was there a couple of times coaching.
Yeah.
And that's how I met Ross.
All right. So what was it about FPWA that made you decide to leave your respective schools and go there? I said I was going to just say your name and then you answer, but I've totally missed that. So we'll start with Ross, just because you're the one next to me in the Zoom chat. So what made you decide to leave W3L and go to FPWA?
I think personally it was the growth that you could get from going to FPWA. Like, Andy Wild is one of these guys. He's done a lot. He's been places. He's done a lot. He's got the experience. He's got that multiple year. He's got that patience to teach you. Like, even if you're just starting, and the environment there is great. Like, and it just kind of makes you want to grow as a performer. Like, just going to FPWA is brilliant.
Would you agree with that, Nate? Or was there another reason for going?
For me, it was kind of, I felt a little bit like I was plateauing slightly, kind of felt fancy to change more than anything, really. It was just a change for me.
Yeah.
Excellent. So we'll go into the oh, sorry, I've interrupted you there.
Sorry.
No, you finish your thought. You were in the middle. I was rude. I interrupted you. What were you saying?
Somewhere I felt that I had connections and could get places faster, if you get what I mean.
Absolutely. So we'll go for the boring questions. We'll kind of just like go back and forth. So if I ask Ross the first question the first time, he'll ask the second question the second time. I think this will be a very odd podcast because I'm certainly learning as I go with these podcast things. And this is the first time I've went for anyone more than one person. So I apologize to you guys if it's going to be a little bit stunted and a bit technical difficulties, but we'll get there eventually between the three of us, I'm sure. So Nate, I'll start with yourself. So what got you hooked into pro wrestling in the first place?
It was about six, so 2006 time. I went to a mate's house and his brother was watching SmackDown, and I can remember it was Paul London, Brian Kendrick tag match. I think they were against Deuce and Domino or something. Watched that, thought it was pretty cool, and then kind of just started from there. And I went through 2012 to 2016, kind of just did not watch it at all. And then the draft happened and got straight back into it. And yeah, that was it for me, really.
Yeah, and Ross?
Well, for me, it was, maybe I was actually very young. I was 4 years old at the time. I think I was watching, it was an episode of SmackDown. It was one of these things you just get hooked by what you're seeing. And it's just so entertaining because you're really, really young. You're entertained by anything that kind of is on the telly, to be honest. And then I think it was a couple, and then I just got really hooked, and I just, it was that desire that, like, this is amazing. And then as I got older, you know, you do backyard wrestling with your pals, it was that kind of thing, and it was just, it got you going and going and going. And then I thought, well, why pretend to do it when you can actually do it? And then I joined W4L a few years ago, and then here we are, FBWA.
It's definitely one of those things where I think if you didn't at some point want to be a wrestler, then I don't think you kind of got wrestling. I mean, I definitely know myself, I wouldn't be a wrestler, but there was always that moment where you were doing a choke slam in the garden, or in my case, trying to do jumps off sheds and thinking I was Mick Foley. But so it's something that's definitely hooked you. So Ross, was there any favourites that sprung to mind that you've enjoyed since you started watching?
CM Punk is up there. He is top there. I just admired everything he done. Like, it's the thing, like, the rule breaking, his promo was amazing. Like, even at the age when he was around, you'd still be mesmerized by everything he said, because you just, wow, like, this guy's for real. This guy's amazing. And of course, you've got John Cena, etc. Because, well, it's John Cena.
Definitely. I mean, so you would be 4, you're 16 now, so that would be 2008. So you're really in that middle of that Cena run and Punk coming up. So definitely two that were out there. And when you're speaking about rule breaking as well, you would have just missed out by a couple of years of Eddie Guerrero and stuff like that. So I'm assuming he's a guy that you probably went back and studied, I would think, if you're into that kind of thing. Nate, for yourself, are there any favourites that you've got when you started watching, and any that you've got now?
Yeah, like around 2006 time, so it's like you're seeing those here, Shawn Michaels, The Undertaker, people like that. I also watched a lot of TNA back then, so I loved AJ Styles and people like that. But my favourite from that period, from when I was younger, was a man who shall not be named. He's still big influence on me today. And yeah, people like that, more the technical wrestlers other than like Cena and stuff like that.
Very similar conversation I have with Johnny Reeves in our last podcast, then. He's very much more of a technical guy, and I think I'm more into Ross's kind of the entertainment and maybe larger in life character kind of guy.
Yeah.
But no, it makes, there's so many things that make a wrestler, does not, no one's right for who they like, I think. No one's wrong. Everyone's right. No one's wrong at all. So when it came to training, of course, not speaking about FPWA for a moment, what was the hardest bit that you found initially when it came to training? Who'd I ask first last time? Ross. So, Nate, what was the hardest bit about your first couple sessions?
For me, it was kind of breaking into the group, because when I went, the group had been together for a while. Because I've always been played rugby for years and stuff like that, so I was a pretty fit guy. So it wasn't that, it was being confident around people, because it was a completely different environment. That was it for me, really. It was more just the mental side for me rather than the physical.
Right. So yeah, so you have that sports background, which I'm sure Ross has as well, if I remember rightly. So you find the aggressive, the physicality a bit easier, because of course rugby is a very physically demanded sport. So it was more did you find the character bit was a bit more difficult to kind of get to as well because of that? I would think, especially if you've, again, from a physical background. Ross, if I remember rightly from a past interview you've done with Westy, you've done MMA, and I think you said that at the start of the interview as well. Yes. So how did you find transferring your MMA skills to wrestling and basically trying not to hit someone for real?
Oh, that's still actually quite a difficulty today. Like, to this day, it's still very difficult, because I've only recently stopped doing MMA, like very recently. So it was hard because when I first started with W3L, it wasn't hard to kind of break into the group because I was in the juniors and the juniors had just started up, you know what I mean? So it was just as if I was just going to start off with everybody else. I wasn't any different. But then it was transitioning into wrestling rather than MMA. But from time to time, like, obviously now in FPW, drills are kind of like a bit of shoot drills, you know what I mean? So that's where I perform best, is on the ground wrestling. And I like that because it makes me think, like, it's not going to be as difficult to transition, if you know what I mean?
Like, yeah, and definitely nowadays, I think wrestling is probably getting closer and closer to your shoot kind of fighting. It's because your bigger companies like your WWE and that, they've got your HD graphics, you've got your everything's got to be as close as possible without it being actually dangerous at the same time. So I suppose if you started maybe 10 years ago, of course you wouldn't have been old enough, but if you started 10 years ago, it would have been a little bit harder, I would think, maybe to pull back a little bit more. But now everything needs to be a little bit realer for people to believe it, I suppose, as well. Mm-hmm. So, Nate, you have wrestled a few matches because we've put your results up on shows. So what was it like in your first match, and how different was it from just training to actually be in front of a crowd?
Completely different. It was terrifying, to say the least. I was against Ian Ambrose, so somebody I know very well, trust completely, very experienced, had him to help me through it and chop the ever-loving bejesus out of me. But yeah, I've never been the most confident on a stage, so drama wasn't a great subject for me in school. But it was kind of weird. It was the first time I got in that ring, it was the crowd just disappeared. I knew they were there, but I didn't feel as nervous as I thought I was going to.
And you were definitely in there with someone who is very well-tuned, especially with the crowd you would have been in front of as well. So it would have made it a little bit easier. I think it would be a bit scarier if you went in with maybe someone that you were training with and it was just 2 years thrown out there in front of just new eyes, just going, who are you guys? But yeah, Ian Ambrose is definitely I don't know whether if he just hasn't like went to other places to try and get in at all, but he's a guy that I've certainly been a fan of since I started watching. That was a long time ago, 2012. So he's definitely a solid hand to certainly start off with. Is there anyone that you particularly want to get in with, like, immediately? I mean, I'm assuming there'll be a long list of names you want to get in the ring with in the future, but is there anyone who you want to face with the next year, for example? Someone maybe from the school or just around the Scottish wrestling scene? Nate, again, I'll start with you.
Well, Ian's definitely somebody I want to get in the ring with again. Still want my rematch. But somebody like Caleb or Rum. I would love to be in the ring with Rum. I'd say Caleb and Grum, the two guys I haven't been in the ring with that I would love to get in the ring with.
You know how to soften me up here. First, you know, Ambrose talk, and then a bit of Caleb as well. And I am a humongous fan of Caleb. Grum, I've not seen a lot of, but I know he's now training at Joe Henry's school, which is, I think, probably not that I know what's better or not, but I think Joe Henry's school is probably a bit more character-driven, and I think that's perfect for someone that's got the size of Grum to kind of tune that character bit. And so if you're finding yourself getting more confident working with Andy and that, certainly going in with someone like a beast like Grum would be amazing. And I mean, Caleb is just huge. Like, he's short in stature, but he's broad. So yeah, that's two great choices. Ross, yourself?
Well, there is a long list of names. I think at the very top, I think it, genuinely, I would love to face Andy. I think at the minute, the style he uses is completely opposite to mine. So I think it would be amazing to see how that would like transform into like a proper match. Like I think it would be really good. There's also, I would love to face Noam Dar. I think that would be a great contest between myself and him, because there's similar wrestling styles there. And I think it would be quite good. But there's so many other names and so many others.
So definitely setting your sights high with especially those two names in there. Andy is, he's one of those guys who the old adage when Husky Harris was around was the Sherman tank with the Ferrari engine, and I think that's Andy Wild, isn't it? He's just ridiculously, he hasn't lost any of the speed he had when he was a lot like lighter, but he's added this extra edge of just terrifying strength at the same time. So usually when we do this show, I don't know if you've listened to any past episodes, this has been a fantastic wrestling podcast. It's been very rare that I actually get to do a wrestling podcast, because it usually divulges into cartoons and just things that aren't wrestling. But I have to ask the question, Ross, I'll start with you. What's your favourite dinosaur?
Probably a velociraptor.
Solid choice. Nate?
Purely for the name, and because it's bloody massive, and I always get pulled. My mum's nickname for me is the Giraffe Boy, because my mum's only 5'3", my brother's 5'7", and I'm 6'2". So the Giraffe Titan.
Sounds like something from Power Rangers. looks like I've got a little bit of interference coming in. We'll just see what's happening there. Seems to have got a extra person in the feed, just connecting the audio now. Maybe he's going to answer the same question. Who knows? He's just chilling.
My favourite dinosaur is Rex the dinosaur from Toy Story. I think Wallace Shawn, the guy who played it, did very well. And I really enjoyed him in the short film, the 2012 short film, Party Source Rex, in which he is the party master for a couple of the bath toys. That is my favourite dinosaur. Bye.
I could not have planned that any better if I tried.
You actually couldn't. I'm going to give you that. That was outstanding.
That's a dinosaur question. Thank you, Kevin Williams, for somehow this has become a thing. It's now the dinosaur question that we ask everyone. I'm surprised no Triceratops. That was a popular answer for a little while, but we've got two great answers, even though one possibly isn't real. But who knows? Were dinosaurs real? So we'll move on from there. So we'll go back to the wrestling chat. We spoke about your favourites then. We'll go for matches, because that's always a good talking point. I find that you can get a real insight to people's favourite styles. I mean, you talk about your favourite wrestlers, but matches, you kind of get a little bit more of an insight. I started with Ross last time. So Nate, a couple of favourite matches, maybe two or three.
So one that I posted on Twitter recently was Kenta Kobashi versus, I don't remember the first thing, but it's Kobashi versus Sakazai from Pro Wrestling Noah, the one that's very famous for the 5 minutes of chops. But that spot's amazing to watch. But the entire match is just perfect old school Japanese heavyweights just trying to kill each other. That one is definite for me. trying to think off the top of my head. There's a Kenta versus Marufuji match from Noah as well. I do love Japanese wrestling, if you can't tell. We've got a lot of them, but there's one specific one. I don't know which one it is by the date of it, but it's the one where Marufuji does a moonsault, springboard moonsault to the outside and catches his throat on barricade and just no-sells it completely. But the rest of that match is just amazing.
I think there's a guy that you might need to meet, and that's Ian Skinner from past podcasts. I think if I hadn't tried to curtail it to memes, I think we've spoken about Japanese wrestling for however long I'd have let him. I know very little about Japanese wrestling, but I'm learning as I go with these recommendations that I'm getting as we go along. So Ross, your maybe two or three favourite matches?
There's about three, yeah. My first one I posted recently on Twitter. Not many people are familiar with, I don't think. It's Kota Ibushi versus Cedric Alexander in the Cruiserweight Classic. I think that match was just unbelievable because I'm a huge fan of the Cruiserweight, in case you can't tell, like, because I am one. Like, and I think my style was really very, very similar to that pace of that match, just high flying and striking. Like, it was just amazing to watch. And the things that Kota Ibushi can pull off and Cedric Alexander can pull off is just unreal. Like the moonsault, when he does the moonsault, he jumps off and does the moonsault and then lands on his feet and falls back. Like, I thought that was outstanding. I thought it was just amazing to watch. Another match was AJ Styles versus John Cena in 2016 at SummerSlam. I thought that was outstanding. And again, to the entertainment point, it was very hyped up, very high. Like, AJ Styles was like, John, you can't beat me. And he couldn't. Like, he couldn't do it. And it was that thought of, oh, he's never going to be able to do it. And AJ Styles beat him. Like, it was well built up. And then another one was CM Punk versus John Cena. CM Punk versus John Cena was
Money in the Bank 2011 or
yeah, that's the one. I thought that was outstanding. That was, I think you can basically tell how that was outstanding. The hype to it, Punk's leaving, Punk leaves with the title. Cena says, "No, I want to do it my way." He doesn't have Vince ring the bell. I thought it was amazing. I really did. I thought it was amazing. Like, especially the age I was. Like, I don't really know what's going on, but the thought of it, you're thinking, "Oh my god, this guy's about to leave with the title. Like, what was going on?" And the wrestling in the match, I thought was brilliant. Because I like wrestling when the crowd is extremely involved. And they were invested in that match. I thought it was just amazing.
So speaking right of right now, at this moment in time, there is no crowd at shows. Well, there is, but it's trainees. What are your thoughts on, I don't know if you've seen it, the Thunderdome that's coming up? As of recording, it hasn't happened yet, but we'll also start with you. Not wrestling in front of a crowd, but wrestling in front of 100, 1,000 screens instead. Do you think, I mean, you haven't, I don't think you've had an actual match itself, but do you think that would be a bit more daunting, that you're in front of that kind of environment, or how do you feel about it?
Well, I've had a couple of training matches. Like, I've had many training matches, actually. But if it was in virtual screens, I'm not really keen on that, to be honest with you. Like, it just doesn't, it's not, it's, I'm saying, like, it's not realistic, but, like, it's not what you're looking for. Like, what's the point of having a bunch of screens there? It's just,
It's the atmosphere, like, isn't it? I mean, I don't,
yeah, it doesn't give you the right atmosphere as it would usually. Like,
I think the I mean, we'll see what Thunderdome actually entails and looks like. But for me, it's like the screen, you'll get the noise, you get a bit of a delay and all that kind of stuff. But as strange as it sounds, the kind of rumble and even the smell, good or bad, make a show. I've been to a few shows which just be bad, but it's that kind of physical entity that you're in front of, again, I haven't wrestled, so I have no idea. I've spoken in front of a crowd. That was as close as I've ever gotten. So Nate, you have been wrestling. You wrestled in front of people. That was my wedding ring there. How would you feel about wrestling in front of a screen, or would you just be happy to be wrestling, full stop?
Well, no, I would just be happy to be wrestling a match. It'd be a bit weird because obviously we're supposed to have like crowd noise, like the obviously live reactions and stuff. But there would be you'd have no feel because you couldn't feel them. Like, see, I've never wrestled in, like the biggest crowd I've been in front of was about 300 people. But they're like obviously the WWE guys, they're used to tens of thousands. And you can feel that, whereas they'll just see a bunch of screens, and the only way for them to really feel how the match has been received is the cesspit of wrestling Twitter after a show.
Yeah, it's a dangerous world, the wrestling Twitter. No, I think they got it. I think they had it right when they did the greatest match of all time. I don't know if you guys saw Edge versus Randy Orton.
Yeah, brilliant.
They had the crowd noise piped in. I don't know whether Edge or Norton actually heard it, but they had the crowd noise in, so it was reacting to each move. I mean, sometimes it was like the old SmackDown Seagulls, which might be a reference that nobody gets, but when there was a crowd, a backstage bit, there was always the sound of seagulls, and it was supposed to be the crowd. But I think that made that match so much better. So we're degreeing, want to wrestle, but it would be weird. That's pretty much what we're getting here. So is there any goals, any companies that you want to venture to? Once we're just assuming that this isn't going to last much longer and we'll be back wrestling, we're going to wrestling shows at the start of the year. So is there any companies that you kind of want to get out to? I assume, obviously, FPWA, their showcase show, whenever that may be. But anywhere else that you'd want to go to start with us?
There's many places that I won't particularly mention many of them now. Like, I won't mention one of them just now. I would love to wrestle for WrestleZone. I would love to wrestle because I've been to a couple of shows there, helped out on a couple of shows there, and it's just I like the atmosphere going to WrestleZone. I think it's brilliant. I would also quite like to wrestle for FCW. Like, I think the way they're going is really good. Like, I've seen a couple of the shows. Like, it's really good. I think it's going really well. Many places. I would quite like to wrestle for SWA. I think that's quite a good company to go for. And obviously Discovery. I've mentioned that a few times. Discovery. I love the atmosphere going to Discovery Wrestling. It's brilliant. Absolutely brilliant.
And yeah, so you're nodding your head there for FCW, so that would definitely be one of them. Yeah. Anywhere else that you'd want to get to?
FCW, obviously. Disco would be one I would love to wrestle for. Full Tilt in Newcastle is one I've got on my bucket list. It may not sound like it, but that is my home. Newcastle's my home. So I want to wrestle down there in front of my family. And they've got a six-sided ring. And being an early 2000 TNA mark, six-sided ring is what I want. the as big as I can get. That's all, I want to wrestle everywhere and anywhere. And as big as I can.
That's agreed. That's good.
Yeah, that's the way to go. I mean, if you're coming into wrestling just to go, I'll just stick to my own place, then that's fine. That's your prerogative, but yeah, if you're wanting to do the lofty heights of like your NXT UK and NXT and vice versa, you got to travel around, you got to get a bit of a buzz about you. So right now, because we're in quarantine, you can't wrestle, but we've already established that numerous times here. How have you found, because right now social media is the way to get your name out. That's just how it has to be. So Nate, how have you found it, especially with yourself saying your confidence isn't the most, you're more an introvert, fair to say that. How have you found trying to get your name out there through social media and the like? Is it difficult or just a learning experience?
If you go on my Twitter, you'd know that I'm not the biggest of posters in the world. And because life's pretty boring at the moment, there's not much happening. So for me, beforehand, my Instagram was purely just me in the gym. So my social media has gone very quiet recently. And I've posted the occasional thing, but yeah, for me, I'm not the biggest online presence. So
it is really. Rob Ross, how have you been finding trying to get your name out there just through all this social media landscape?
It's very difficult. It really is, seeing as I've not like officially debuted. It's really hard, but I agree with Nate. Like, is this nothing's really going on in the world, so you can't exactly like. There's nothing to post about, if you know what I mean. Like, there's nothing to talk about, nothing to post about. This is like my Twitter. On the occasional time, I'll post a wee comment or whatever just to say how I'm doing, like everybody's doing. I post quite. I don't want to say regularly, but occasionally, kind of. I post on Instagram. My Instagram is RossHunterPW. Anybody's trying to find it? Yeah.
We'll do your social media plugs at the end. Don't worry about that. We'll get that in. So that's why I've done this podcast, really, because, I mean, same as you guys, I have nothing to post. The website is reviews, results, news, and there's none of it. So it's very difficult to actually write results on shows that don't happen. So the podcast, there was one particular troll that really annoyed me, going on about, oh, you're only speaking to trainees and you're only speaking to people that haven't actually wrestled. But when the shows start again, you guys will be wanting to wrestle. So the podcast here is really just to kind of get your name out there. And if we end up chatting about cartoons and dinosaurs, then great. I'm going to enjoy that anyway. But so it's great that you guys were happy to come on and go through all the, like I said, the unprofessional professionalness of this podcast, which is just, we're hoping for the best, and hashtag pray for laptop every time we come on. So thank you guys for taking part, and hope we'll see your names on the results when I do the old typing of results of shows again. I'll see your name aplenty. So before we wrap up this little round table that we've got going on, this triangle of tether of wrestling, we'll plug your social media. So Nate, we'll start with yourself. Where can people find you? When you do post, where can people find you?
So my Instagram is NateStevensonPW. There's a double S, Stephen, Ben, and then my Twitter is just Nate Stevenson. Too many digits.
I'm sure if they type Nate Stevenson, they'll be fine. And Ross, you did plug your Instagram. What about your Twitter or Facebook or whatever else you got?
My Twitter is Cal McLean X1. Unfortunately, obviously Twitter doesn't let you change your username. So yeah, it's also my personal account. I've got a Facebook as well, just Ross Hunter. Ross Hunter, you should find it. And Instagram is Ross Hunter PW.
Excellent. Might help you change you can change your Twitter username. So I'll see if we can help you out with that.
Oh, sorry. So, I've tried for so long. I've never been able to do it.
So that may have changed by the time this goes out, but we'll tag you in it. It'll be fine. People will find you. Thank you for joining us. I hope you've enjoyed. People that are watching or listening, hope you've enjoyed this little roundtable of Fife Pro Wrestling Asylum trainees and students. And I'm sure we'll be seeing the names Ross Hunter and Nate Stevenson soon enough, once the world is back to the new normal that it is. But for now, thank you for joining us, and